1,200 miles off the coast of New England, is one of the richest fishing grounds on Earth. The Grand Banks.
Yeah, baby.
Home to brutal weather and unpredictable seas. This is where the perfect storm exploded. Over the years, thousands of lives have been lost here. Yet every fall, a few brave fishermen risk everything as they sail these deadly waters in search of giants. It's just 2 weeks into the fall season, and the fleet has already experienced broken bones and costly delays. Some are on the fish.
Watch these boys pull in that nice 250-pounder.
While others are just trying to catch up.
Fishing's really horrible. I've just had enough of it.
Now life is on the line as the search for swords continues. Miles off the coast of Newfoundland, the Seahawk and Captain Linda Greenlaw are hoping to turn their luck around.
Our delays to this point have been very costly. We've missed some good fishing and we've added to our expenses.
So far, the Seahawk has endured a nightmare season. Equipment failure and bad fishing has cost them time and money.
Mostly empty hooks, so you can't catch them if they're not biting.
And for Linda Greenlaw, her crew's confidence.
I quit.
We hope to get 8 sections of gear in the water, so we'll have pretty close to 900 hooks out.
Going fishing, Mikey.
About time, huh?
Yeah. Try not to get any mackerel on my coffee, buddy.
Let her rip, ladies.
Got it, Tim.
It's on, right?
Yes, it's on.
The first beeper buoy is in the water. Once the crew sets out the 30 miles of mainline, they cut the gear loose to drift. Then, like a homing device, the signal from the beeper will guide them back to the head of their line.
Everything okay?
So far, so good.
We're fishing, Skip! We're fishing, boys!
It takes the crew over 5 hours to set their gear as they work into the night.
Hottest fishing trip I ever been on in my life. Man, I'm really, really gonna change professions.
This part of the job is nerve-wracking. I'm a wreck. The guys need to see a little blood on the deck. That's what we're here for, and it'll make us all feel better.
Fifty miles to the northeast, the Eagle Eye 2 under Captain Scotty Drabinowitz is hauling their first set since returning from Newfoundland.
Lost about a week of fishing, trying to get on track, but not looking too good here for us today.
We're really under the gun here.
5 days ago, Scotty lost a crewman when Kenny hit the deck hard. He broke his wrist, and Scotty was forced to motor him 300 miles to Newfoundland. He was replaced by fellow Newfie, Tommy Fox.
Yeah, I got a phone call 2 nights ago. He said that Eagle Eye 2 was on our way in. Scotty was the skipper, and I said, yes, sir, no problem. I'll go fishing with him any day. He knows how to catch fish.
Scotty now needs to cover the $40,000 in fuel costs and lost fishing.
Fishy.
Oh, blue dog.
Every time we get rid of one,
Last night, Scotty's line drifted into colder water. Now there's nothing but blue sharks on the line, which have no commercial value.
The temperature of the water is shark.
Blue dog. And here comes his brother and sister and grandmother.
Right now, we're in the middle of a hostile takeover by the cold water. I don't anticipate in catching really anything other than sharks.
That's bad news for the crew. But good news for Lisa Natanson, a shark biologist hitching a ride in the name of research.
I take information on the species, on the length, the sex of the fish condition.
Thank you, Daryl.
This is our tag here, which has information on what to do if you catch it in 5 different languages, and it implants into the shark like that.
Yeah, we're definitely gonna have to mix it up here, come up with a new game plan.
Unless Scotty can find a better piece of water, he won't cover his expenses, and his crew won't get paid. 150 miles off the coast of New England, the Frances Anne is getting ready to fish under Captain Chris Clem.
Here now, it's pretty nice all morning. We had like 20 knots, 15, 20 knots of westerly.
Greenhorn Ben and best friend Lemmy are already on deck. So far, Ben's had a shaky start to his first fishing trip.
6 stops to a bundle. Ben, I'm not out here to make friends. I'm out here to make money.
And now it's about to get a whole lot worse for the greenhorn.
Here it is. Watch out, watch out, watch out, watch out, watch out.
As the boat rolls, Ben grabs at Lemmy and nearly pulls him overboard. Lemmy's realizing friends and fishing don't always mix.
I thought he'd be able to do it, actually. And it sucks, because it's killing me, it's killing Brian. We gotta work double as hard. I mean, there's nothing he can do. He's out here, he's stuck 2 weeks. Gotta grind it out.
You never know what's going to be on the end of it there. That's why it's so exciting. It could be a dead shark, could be a 200-pound sword, could be a tire. I have no idea what's on there.
This is their fourth haul back, and with 7,000 pounds already in the hold, Chris is looking to continue his winning streak.
Come on, fish. Live tuna. Get a gaff. Back up gaff. Gaff.
Gaff. Gaff.
This big-eyed tuna could be a huge payday for the crew. If it doesn't break free,
pull them in the boat.
Tuna's worth 3 times more than swordfish, and this whopper could fetch over $1,000.
We don't have a big eye up there yet.
But tuna isn't the only thing they're catching.
Good fish.
Heads up, heads up, heads up.
Stick with the stand, boss.
Get on the other side of me so you don't.
Good take now for the bill.
That's where it's at right there. Look at that. $1.50 right there.
That gets me excited.
Everything is working. Everything except Ben.
Ben, you can't stand around and just stare at them, guys. It's the same thing. Every fish, box hook, gaff. No time to stand around for picture taking.
Ben, to be honest, I thought I'd actually get to see you move fast out here.
I move fast, Mom. On a surfboard.
On a surfboard.
I pretty much knew what I was getting myself into because a lot of my friends are longliners. And then I got out here and I was like, wow, this kind of sucks.
Come on, Ben, there's 3 leaders hanging on the rail. You can get a drink later.
Man, you don't see it on the rail? Hold a job on land. Stand by, Ben. Don't be a hero. Just be retarded.
Dude, I think my wrist just popped out. Yo, my wrist just.
Hold on.
Yeah, it's
100% popped out, dude.
What?
My wrist just popped out. Pull it back in, please.
What do you want me to do?
Just pull it.
What happened?
I don't know, man. My wrist just literally popped out.
Now you go like this?
No, I think it's out of the joint, man.
Oh yeah, it's swollen up. Look.
Feels man. Feels like it's not in the place.
Come inside.
It hurts like hell if you actually broke your wrist. I've done it several times, dude.
Stop. You gotta stop twitching, dude. You gotta relax, alright?
It feels awful, dude. It feels like it might be broken.
That's why you never take a greenhorn. You've never been wet before.
This greenhorn's injury jeopardizes the crew's trip and their paycheck.
Worst case scenario, having to go all the way to hell back to the dock to drop them off, breaking a trip, which is the worst thing ever. And we got a real good trip going here now. We've only made 5 sets. And it would be a huge disappointment to the guys if we had to quit right now. Huge disappointment. You guys hurt, the guys hurt.
Hundred miles off the coast of Newfoundland, the Seahawks saga continues. It's 5 a.m. and legendary skipper Linda Greenlaw's already having a tough day.
Still not quite sure of the ADFs. You know, one shows it one side of the bow, the other one shows it on the other side of the bow.
Deep in the notorious Grand Banks fog, she's where her gear should be. But her first beeper's malfunctioning. Its signal is too weak to track. Now, Linda must guess where the currents have dragged 40 grand worth of fishing gear.
Doing a lot better when I get on the end of the gear here. Oh, we're close. We're close to it. I see it.
You're on it.
Thank you. Right. I mean, a lot of birds around. I see a big slick spot coming up here that sometimes means a swordfish. All the signs are here.
The first hooks are coming up empty.
Got something coming here, Mike. Fish on!
Feisty side.
Yeah! Oh, yeah! That's what I'm talking about.
The first sword's a marker.
The markers, the 100-pound fish are worth the most money per pound. You're better off with one 100-pound fish than you are two 50-pound fish, price-wise. Fish on! There you go.
After weeks of bad luck and delays, the Seahawks back in the game.
That's more like it.
I love sword fishing.
Like to see a few more.
It's awesome, Linda. All right, getting better. We have company right behind us.
What?
We have company right behind us.
Just a half mile off the Seahawks port side, the big guys emerged out of the fog, close enough for Captain Chompers to see what Linda's catching.
From watching other boats, you can usually see if they're catching something or if they're not catching.
Looks fishy, doesn't it? Fishing.
Grand Banks boats don't usually fish this close together, but Chompers is well known throughout the fleet for his aggressive fishing style.
Chomps, he's pretty aggressive.
A little bit more underhanded and sneaky.
Sometimes his aggression pushes the envelope a little bit too far.
So far, he's struck out on the Grand Banks.
We've hauled 500 hooks for one fish.
Now this desperate owner-operator will do anything to save his season.
I got a fish coming right there.
Woo-hoo!
It's a nice fish.
Holy man!
That's the kind.
300 pounder.
The huge triple marker could be worth over $2,000 if they can get it on the boat.
What a guy they're doing. He's doing it wrong.
For this monster, Linda breaks out the winch and a 4-foot-long stainless steel hook.
Let it play, Dave. You just can't hold it still.
solid this time. Yeah.
Oh yeah, baby.
Holy man.
A lot of food.
Hello. Hello. Hello, gorgeous. How are you?
That's what we want, boys.
That's what I'm talking about.
How much does that weigh?
$3.50.
Right on.
That's a solid, solid, healthy North Atlantic fish. Fish like that are full of protein, full of all kinds of good stuff. Get two more of them, we call it a good day. I'm not kidding you.
Land up another pass by you here.
I hear you still having beeper problems.
What's your status?
You know, I can't believe that seven beepers that are working on the boat all kind of suck.
I can hook you up with a couple beepers if that would help you.
Might take you up on it, over.
I'll be up there on the north side of the tower.
On the Grand Banks, captains help each other out all the time.
They're going to take this one, and they're going to take this one. These two right here.
Yeah, maybe a wolf in sheep's clothing, I guess, but it'll be like now or never deal, you know?
But stalking the Seahawk was a strategic move by chompers to find the fish.
Thank you!
You're welcome. Adios, amigo!
As the sun hits the horizon, the desperate captain's chomping at the bit to stake his claim, and his kid brother's just not moving fast enough.
Woody's killing me, man. 10 minutes trying to get him to throw the buoy. Woody! Come on, man! Throw the buoy! Killing me here! Take you an hour to do that! Throw the buoy! Woody! You need to get the hell over there to your box!
Been yelling. I don't like yelling.
Moving like a turtle.
We're running out of time. Just a little fire under his I guess would be what I'm doing.
Captain's always right. Don't argue with the cap.
I need a fire put under my so I can get catching. I'm letting myself down, my boat down, my crew down. Try. That's all I can do.
At the eastern edge of the Grand Banks, over 300 miles from shore, the Seahawk still hauling in gear and swordfish.
Nice swordy.
Keep getting a little taste of really nice fish and wishing we had more.
I'll try another set here, no doubt. Nice fish.
Watch the bill, okay, buddy?
Got him.
Yay!
Captain Linda Greenlaw's landed a prime patch of fishing real estate.
Whoa, Linda. Nice sword.
He's a long one.
There's a nice one.
Now, Linda has discovered that Chompers has set out within spitting distance of her gear.
I had to turn and go east because I was running into the big eye, their gear. They moved up.
It's the stink eye.
He didn't say anything on the radio until he was already there, setting.
The longliner's fishing code gives the first boat in an area rights on that berth. Boats arriving later should respect a mile buffer around the first boat's gear.
I'm watching them haul gear off the top of my gear.
They're really going across our line?
Ah, look at the he's got towing there.
The big guy's buggering us.
One reason longliners give each other's gear a wide berth is to avoid running over someone's main line and severing it. When the line splits, it's called a part-off.
Dead.
Oh.
And it's a time-killing mess to sort out.
That's what friends like Chopper are for.
It's all the whole mess aboard, gentlemen.
It's going under the boat now.
Miles of tangled line on deck is only half the problem.
You can put it forward if you want now. We're off.
Even worse, they now have to hunt down the rest of their gear.
Really getting frustrating. You know, we need to fish. We can't just bob around out here.
Looked to me like another fishing boat might have parted us off.
Yeah, I know who it was.
Things like this, part off and chasing a beeper that doesn't work. It all just costs time.
There it is, right there.
Oh, good eyes, Tim.
How'd you see it? 10 miles up the break, eagle eye? Straight at it, right there.
Great, good eyes.
I'll see Jimmy Hoffa before I see it.
Yes. Thank God.
Just parted us off and said, you.
Yeah, he did, didn't he, Dave?
Less than a mile to the east, the big eye is finally landing some fish.
Nice.
God bless big eye!
But the captain knows he's got a long way to go before his boat's in the black.
The crew won't get any money right now. If we leave and go in, the crew won't make a penny, because expenses always come before the crew gets paid. As of right now, they have nothing. You gotta be kidding me.
Well, we just potted off.
The big eye's slow climb out of a financial pit just got a whole lot tougher.
So I gotta go tell the skipper and potted off, and then we gotta go look for the gear and pick it up.
What's the next beeper we're looking for?
It's 1902,
To find their gear, they've got to find the next beeper, but each beeper has a different frequency, and no one knows which beeper they're looking for.
They go out in an order. Number one gets mixed up with number four. I don't know which way to go.
We had it already written down. We ran it down twice. The beeper order, that's not the right order. You already lost the one that had the right order.
What good is this, man? What good is it then? If the beeper order ain't the same, I mean, what the good is it? Normally, I would go to the next beeper that was wrote down on the paper, and it would be it. If that was the case, I'd be running a 1770, but that's on the boat.
The beeper list isn't worth the paper plate it's written on.
I might as well just wipe my with it, because it's no good.
And the beeper they've been tracking is already on board. Chompers has been chasing his own tail.
Man, these guys are killing me, man.
Been up here for 10 minutes trying to listen to something. It's masters.
I ain't gonna take a busting from him like that. That sucks.
There's a better way of telling somebody than screaming at them.
No matter if I piss off President Ronald Reagan or whoever it is, I don't care who I piss off. I gotta get a trip, you know what I mean?
We'll get it together. Might take a little bit.
It takes over an hour to locate the missing gear.
We got it. The skipper seemed like he mellowed out a little bit now, but I'm staying away still.
Miles from home, the Eagle Eye 2's on a new piece of water, and Captain Scotty's hoping tomorrow he'll catch more than sharks.
Right now, I know the warm water is sliding up under the cold and it's pushing up here into the north, which is always a good thing.
It could be real good for the Eagle Eye 2. I certainly hope so.
Scotty's trying to drop his hooks where the cold water of the Labrador Current meets the warm water of the Gulf Stream. The temperature break is rich with nutrients, schools of baitfish, and predators like swordfish.
Just warmed up a little bit. We're starting to get a nice little layer on the scope, cold side of the warmer water, which we call the cold side of the edge. And keep our fingers crossed. We'll see how it goes.
The gear in the wheelhouse only shows the surface temperature, but the hooks will be at 60 feet. So Scotty checks the temperature at hook depth to be sure the bait's on the break.
Well, water's cooling off here now. What I was hoping for. I don't know if we're running right up the edge here, if it's just a real, real wide piece. Tomorrow will tell.
We got like a piece of water busted off the main edge. Okay. So we might have something good here.
So it could be a real busy day tomorrow, man.
Right?
I hope it is too.
I think that's why Scott does better than anybody else. He kind of goes off, tries different things, and not afraid to get away from everybody else.
Scotty thinks he's found what he's looking for, but he won't know until he hauls the gear. 800 miles to the southwest, the Francis Ann's down a deckhand, and Captain Chris Clem may have to cut the trip short.
I hope we don't have to go in. I hope we don't have to break the trip because of Ben's hand. I mean, that would be terrible.
Hey, come here. I mean, what do you want me to do? I mean, tell me what you want me to do.
Do you think it's broken? Do you think it's that severe?
I don't really think it's broken.
I mean, what did you do? Freaking nature, lack of milk, what?
I mean, I don't want to keep you out here. If you think something's wrong with it, I'm asking you.
I want to finish the trip.
All right, well, just so you know that I'm setting out tonight.
Yeah, set out tonight.
All right, just so you know, the gear's in the water, so if you wake up uncomfortable, you know I got to haul the gear up before I can do anything.
No.
All right, just so you're aware of the situation.
We're down a man, so now we all got to contribute a little more. I got to take care of Ben's job. I got to run the boat. Lemmy's gonna have to board the hooks tomorrow, do Dobbs. Everybody's gonna have to cut fish tomorrow. We're all gonna have to pitch in.
Tonight, it takes the crew of the Francis Ann longer than normal to set their gear. But the real question is whether Ben will be around for tomorrow's haul.
Who knows? For all we know, that bag of peas and carrots Ben put on his hands like some new miracle cure. So maybe tomorrow morning, he'll be all healed with miracle peas and carrots.
By morning, the frozen vegetables have failed to provide a miracle cure.
Benny boy,
comfortable? You okay with being out here today?
Yeah, I'm fine. Why not? We're not going anywhere.
Ben's decided to sleep it off.
All right, Benny boy, keep us posted.
If I was in Ben's position, it would take an awful lot to keep me off the deck. Like, obvious bone displacement. Everything hurts. We all work in pain.
Despite being a man down, the crew's still hauling up fish. Now everyone's being pushed to their limit.
It's hard with one less pair of hands.
Watch your wrist. I'm really disappointed Ben hasn't shown his face yet.
Yeah.
Even a courtesy call. A cigarette, bring the guy a cupcake.
A donut would actually be awesome.
I see no donuts. I see no cake. Lemmy's hungry. Sounds stupid, but actually it's going smoother than with an extra guy right now.
Today, the three-man crew is managing to haul the gear on board. But as fatigue sets in, the job will get a whole lot tougher and more dangerous. Fifteen 1,500 miles from their home port of Wan Chees, North Carolina, the Big Eyes about to haul a line they set 12 hours earlier.
And away we go, gentlemen!
Captain Chompers has been buckling under the stress of a dismal season and potential financial disaster. In his hold is just $6,000 worth of fish.
It's just the way that it goes. Just have to deal with it.
While Chompers sulks, 62-year-old veteran John Weeks takes charge.
I'm just kind of taking a break from the hauling and pouting a little bit.
Look at that. Nice little keeper. Fish on. Top of the morning, America.
Good morning, darling.
The first hook comes up with a live sword and, more importantly, a glimmer of hope.
He's nice and shiny this morning.
I thought he wanted a keeper, y'all. He's very deep in the boat.
Adam,
I didn't see it.
I told you.
I said, you'll see him better when you get him on the boat.
I'm happy right now. Let him keep coming.
Did you see a fish first thing in the morning like that? That's a good sign.
We go with our fish.
Well, at Weeks, y'all, he can do just as good a job, boost his morale. Anytime they catch a fish with me out on the, not on the deck, it boosts his morale.
We could handle it. You know, the captain was a little bit down from yesterday. Better for him to stay in his sleep than to come on deck and get mad.
Captain should become the cook, because we're out here catching all these fish. I think he's better off in the cabin. I ain't got to listen to him argue with me all day.
Marker, come on.
Yes.
Something on the deck.
With chompers in the wheelhouse, the big eye is finally catching some fish.
Triple marker. Wonderful.
The triple marker could be worth over $1,500.
Not home.
Woo, baby.
That'll go a long way toward covering the expenses and paying the crew.
I told you, as soon as you start hauling, catch a marker.
We'll have them stacked up like cordwood.
Fish on!
Over the last 6 hours, the crew has stuffed the boat with over 3,500 pounds of fish. Finally, Choppers hits the deck for a progress report.
It came out of the cage.
He will open up the hole, he will get the heart attack.
The day's catch could be worth almost 20 grand. It looks like the big eye has finally broken even.
I have covered my trip expenses with a little luck. The next 3 to 4 set should be a positive trip on the fishing vessel Big Eye. And then it will be worthwhile for us coming to the Grand Banks.
I'm gonna let you keep doing what you're doing, Weeks.
20 miles to the south, Captain Linda Greenlaw wants to get her gear in the water before the weather hits.
We're going to be setting early because it is supposed to blow about 30. If we can get the gear in the water before it blows, that'd be nice, a little easier on the guys.
Start early, get down early.
It's kind of rough going this way. I have to go this way to cool the water off, so the way it is. Let her rip.
It takes the crew 3 hours to drop a third of their gear as they struggle against the building seas. Setting out in foul weather is cold, miserable, and dangerous. And one of the biggest risks is what's known as backlash. The main line's caught in the drum gears, and it's stopped unspooling. The Seahawks now dragging the line and stretching it.
Back it down a bit.
At any moment, the line could snap back like a stretched rubber band, bringing razor-sharp hooks flying through the air. It's a race to clip on a beeper and cut the line free before it snaps.
Setting out in bad weather with the boat surging up and down, and the line gets very tight behind the boat. When you go up on a sea, the line gets a little slack. You do that just right, you get a backlash. The line gets very slack on the drum and starts sort of flying around the deck. It's dangerous.
It's the worst thing that can happen. You can freaking take an eye out. You can wrap around somebody and rip them overboard. It can bring hooks back into the boat and snag people up. The line came off the spool, got stuck in the barren, came tight. Super dangerous.
Here we are with yet another fiasco aboard the Seahawk. It's dangerous, and I'm glad nobody, you know, got close to it.
It's off here. I don't know if it's broke.
Don't touch nothing. Stay out of it, Dave. Trust me.
The spool's hopelessly jammed, so Archie fires up a butane torch to melt the line. The crew of the Seahawk won't be able to set out any more gear or catch any fish until they clear the drum.
So we might spend most of the night running this line out and then bringing it back in.
On the eastern edge of the Grand Banks, the Seahawk and Captain Linda Greenlaw are stuck after a backlash tangled their main line tight into the drum.
We have 3 sections, basically 10 miles of line in the water.
Oh, this is up.
The guys have been an hour and a piece getting the line out of the bearing, burning it, melting it, pulling little pieces out.
After 2 hours, the crew finally frees the last of the tangle, but the weather has come up, and now it's too rough to finish their set.
They just pulled the rest of the slack line off the drum, and we were calling it a night.
Just pulled it. Yeah, I know. I'm tired of it.
Just another page in the Seahawks trip, I guess. Sure, the guys are wicked discouraged, but, you know, tomorrow's another day.
20 miles to the northeast, the Eagle Eye 2's back to the start of its 40-mile mainline, and everyone's asleep, except First Mate Daryl.
It's 3:50 in the morning. Time to get the guys up.
Scotty, it's time to get up.
Don't usually get the captain up first.
Morning.
Getting his coffee and everything, and I get the rest of the crew up. He didn't come out here to sleep. He came out here to work, so when you finish fish, then you can get your rest.
I got about 2.5-3 hours.
When everybody's ready, we start holding the gear.
Time to go to work, boys.
It's not going to be an easy day on the Eagle Eye 2. A nor'easter is churning up the North Atlantic and blowing 40 knots.
Weather's all choppy.
But Scotty's got $40,000 worth of gear out there, and the crew's got no choice but to get it back on the boat.
Flat out, that's bottom line. I just want these big fish to show.
Sharks destroyed Scotty's previous set. So last night, after careful temperature measurements along the break, Scotty set into a new stretch of water.
We're geared up for the cold weather. There we go.
What do we got? What do we got?
Finally, a sign that things might turn around. With more fish hitting the deck, Scotty's search for the break is working out. The fish are exactly where he thought they'd be.
All right.
This break.
But the North Atlantic isn't giving up its swordfish without a fight. At the end of the day, there's 4,000 pounds of swordfish on board.
This is what we like to see.
But the work's only half done. The crew must now pack the catch in sea ice to keep it fresh for the rest of the trip.
Oh yeah, we have a big day, a lot of fish to pack.
We don't mind. Just a part of catching the fish. Gotta pack and put them up.
We're on our second haul back here. It was a little slow to begin with, but finished up pretty good. Actually, I think we did better than everybody. So it kind of makes me happy. Turned out to be a good day for us.
800 miles to the southwest is the Francis Ann under Captain Chris Clem. The boat was on a hot streak, but now they're a man down. Greenhorn Ben Ramos is bedridden with a sore wrist.
Ben said he's gonna sit in his bunk today and tape up his hand and maybe try it tomorrow, but you know, if anything can happen in an hour, he can change his mind. We'll check on him throughout the day. I'm sure he'll pop up soon enough and come out. Come on, fish.
The crew has been picking up Ben's slack, but it's starting to wear on them.
About 170, 180 pounds.
Alright, so what's Ben doing? I'm gonna have Ben take a watch while I'm outside making hooks with the guys.
Hey Ben, wanna watch this while you make hooks, please?
Thanks.
Ben knows what to do. He's took a watch and a ride out. Your eyes out and about, you know, if the alarm goes off, if Ben's not too sure what to do,
come and get somebody and don't wait till the last minute.
It was nice to actually do something today, though. I felt bad that I was just sitting around for 2 days. I really hope I get to do the next trip. Pretty optimistic about it.
I saw him slumped over and I snuck around to the front of the wheelhouse and looked in the window and he's asleep. So right now I'm not happy with Ben for just, I mean, he slept for 2 days straight, pretty much, laid in his bunk, laid down there. Right now, I just think he's milking it for a little more than it's worth.
He is probably the worst person I've ever dealt with on this boat.
He's still gonna be one of my best friends, but he ain't a fisherman, that's for sure.
With Ben unable to pull his weight, Clem has to decide between fishing a man down or hitting port and searching for a new deckhand.
It's original.